Good morning. I'm Archie Clutter. I'm Dean of the Agricultural Research Division here at the University of Nebraska, and it's my pleasure to welcome you all to this session on exploring the development of water stress tolerant crops using new technologies in plant phenomics. It's no secret to this audience that to meet the challenges of future food and water security will require really unprecedented innovation in breeding approaches and the development of new crop varieties, and especially in the face of global climate change. And the sensing and imaging available through new technologies in plant phenomics provides an opportunity to achieve that level of new innovation, linking genomic variation to new phenotypes for plant growth and physiology gives us the potential, at least, for unlocking new information on plant water, nutrient, and photosynthetic efficiencies. So it's in that context that we think about how to connect genomic variation with these phenotypes across a range of environments. If you think about in the context of topic areas of this conference, it might be useful to think about water use efficiency and the components of evapotranspiration. While management techniques like no-till, use of cover crops, precision irrigation can impact surface evaporation, plant transpiration can be addressed through improved water use efficiency and related breeding and biotechnology strategies. So it's there that high throughput phenotyping can be a way to quantify morphological and biophysical traits associated with water use efficiency on a large number of plants, thereby increasing the rate of discovery and shortening the breeding cycle. An overriding challenge with this technology is to be able to translate the results across increasingly larger productions of scale. And at the University of Nebraska, we continue to invest in plant phenomics platforms across scales. Starting in 2014, we brought a growth chamber-sized unit online, a Lemnitech HDS system that applies visible infrared, non-infrared, and fluorescent cameras across small plants, primarily Arabidopsis. In 2015, brought online a greenhouse facility across the street here that I hope you have an opportunity to see if you haven't seen it already, that can accommodate plants up to 2.5 meters in height. And then this spring, we'll be bringing online a 1-acre field facility. A little bit more about those last two units. This unit across the street in our Greenhouse Innovation Center has capacity for 672 plants. Okay, let's see. I'm not sure how to move that mouse around, actually. Oh, there, I guess it's going, thanks. So, 672 plants, application of visible, infrared, fluorescent, and hyperspectral cameras. And again, the conveyors and the ceiling height is such that we can accommodate plants up to maturity or up to 2.5 meters in height. You can also see some of the automated watering systems, weighing and watering systems through which nutrients can also be provided. And then the facility that's about 30 miles north of here at our Agricultural Research and Development Center is on a 1-acre plot with subsurface drip irrigation. So you can see that system being installed under the leadership of Dr. Swat Ermach that provides us with precision irrigation, and then a system on cables that we've built in partnership with SpiderCam that can carry the same cameras that I described earlier over a 1 acre field plot. So this capacity, both in terms of the faculty capacity that we continue to add, you're going to hear from some of those faculty today, but we've added well over 100 tenure track positions to our institute over the last 5 years, many of them in the core areas that we'll be able to use these phenomics platforms and in other areas related to plant stress and water utilization, as well as building to other platforms at other scales within the institute and within the university. UAVs, for example, and then within the Center for Advanced Land Management Information Technologies, CalMet, which is based in our School of Natural Resources, capabilities for canopy imaging and in an aircraft platform. So we continue to work at connecting these phenomic capabilities across multiple scales. Well, we're going to have an opportunity here today to hear from some of the University of Nebraska faculty who are making use of these platforms. We're going to hear from one of our collaborators at another institution about their approach to leveraging these technologies in phenomics, and then from one of our private sector partners. So I'm going to go ahead and give you a brief introduction of each of these panel members, and then I'm going to ask each of them to make a presentation. And we'll ask you to write down your questions and your comments so that once each of the panel members has had a chance to present, we'll come back and open the floor for questions and discussion. Our first panel member is Dr. Pat Morgan, senior scientist with LI-COR Biosciences and an adjunct professor in the School of Natural Resources at the University of Nebraska. At LI-COR, Pat advances scientific discoveries by developing solutions, applications, and instruments for measuring plant responses to the environment. And at the University of Nebraska, conducts research on plant level measurements with an emphasis on water and carbon. Pat was previously a postdoctoral researcher at USDA ARS and at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. He holds a doctorate in plant breeding from the University of Illinois. Welcome, Pat. Dr. Yufeng is assistant professor in the Department of Biosystems Engineering here at the University of Nebraska. Yufeng's research, Yufeng's research focuses on sensing and instrumentation development for agriculture and the natural resources, and continues to contribute leadership in our university's plant phenotyping efforts through collaboration with plant scientists, statisticians, and computer scientists. His work is supported by the NSF, USDA, and Nebraska Commodity Boards. He holds bachelor and master's degrees in mechanical engineering from Nanjing Forestry University and a PhD in agriculture and biological engineering from Texas A&M. Welcome, Yufeng. Dr. Addie Thompson is a postdoctoral researcher in the Department of Agronomy at Purdue University. Dr. Thompson's research focus at Purdue is really at the core of our topic today, connecting high-throughput genomics and phenomics to improve drought tolerance in crops. Growing maize in the desert of Arizona has enabled her to characterize elite lines from public and private breeding initiatives in the U.S. and Mexico, including drought-tolerant maize for Africa program. She works at Purdue with engineers, aviation technologists, and computer vision specialists to leverage aerial image data to predict sorghum productivity, and she works closely with IBM Research for statistical modeling and machine learning. She holds a doctorate in plant breeding and molecular genetics from the University of Minnesota and a Bachelor of Science in Genetics from Iowa State University. Welcome, Addie. Dr. James Schnable. James is assistant professor in the Department of Agronomy and Horticulture. He's a fellow at the Daugherty Water for Food Institute and a member of both the Center for Plant Science Innovation and the Quantitative Life Sciences Initiative here at the University of Nebraska. Research in his lab focuses on new methods to combine phenotypic and functional genomic data across multiple domesticated grain crops and their wild relatives, and he leverages close collaborations with computer scientists, statisticians, engineers, and applied plant breeders. James holds a BA from Cornell University and a PhD from the University of California, Berkeley, and had postdoctoral training at the Danforth Center and the Chinese Academy of Agricultural Sciences. His research is currently supported by the National Science Foundation, USDA, DOE, and the Nebraska Corn Growers Association, as well as private industry. And in the last 5 years, he's co-founded two startup companies. Welcome, James. And Harkamal Walia. Harkamal is an associate professor in the Department of Agronomy and Horticulture and a fellow in the Daugherty Water for Food Institute. He is a plant molecular physiologist who studies plant physiological and molecular responses to drought, heat, and salt stress. His lab uses phenomics, genomics, computational, and physiological approaches to determine mechanisms of abiotic stress tolerance in cereals such as wheat, rice, and maize, with an overall research goal to understand genes and genetic variants that can be used to improve crop performance in suboptimal conditions. Harkamal earned his PhD in plant biology at the University of California, Riverside, and a Bachelor of Science in Plant Breeding and Genetics from Punjab University, Agricultural University. Welcome, Harkamal. All right, well, I'm going to turn the floor over to Dr. Morgan, and his formal contribution is entitled Instruments for Rapid Continuous Assessment of Water Use and Carbon Assimilation from Leaf Level to Entire Field. Welcome.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to share with you a little bit of what we do at LI-COR Biosciences. We're a Lincoln-based company that's about 45 years in business. We're privately held, and we build scientific equipment to empower scientists to make changes in the world. And so we're looking for Morgan. The instruments that we build range from measuring things at the molecular level all the way to atmospheric CO2 flux. And what I want to talk to you today about is, once we get it up here, the atmospheric CO2 flux, which is a way of measuring water use, water uptake or transpiration, the evapotranspiration out of the system, and also making a measurement of CO2 uptake within larger agronomic systems. I'm looking to the back here as we're going. And so maybe I'll do a little interpretive dance as we're getting this queued up. So basically, we're looking at tower approaches. And so this is a way of putting instrumentation out in the field that is permanently deployed. There we go. So we got it up. We're looking at tower deployment, and these instruments continuously measure what's going on underneath them. So there's a footprint. It's using the eddy covariance technique. And when we look at this, we're looking at the flux of water in and out of a system. We're looking at the flux of CO2 in and out of a system. So it's a way of validating a lot of the smaller scale phenomics that are occurring. Whoops. I don't know what I did here. So when we're looking at the eddy covariance solution, we actually looking at a complete system. In the case of the LI-COR instrumentation, we provide you instruments as well as the software. So right on your desktop, you actually will get the uptake answer. So you'll get evapotranspiration in real time, well, within mostly real time. It's about 30-minute delay through a processing that actually occurs, uploads that to the network, and you can view that anywhere in the world on your stations. And so we build this, but we also build leaf-level photosynthesis equipment. And this is designed to make measurements of what's going on individual leaves. And so we recently introduced the newest version of that. It measures water use, carbon uptake, and also chlorophyll fluorescence simultaneously on a leaf area of about 6 square centimeters. And why that's important is if you're looking at a bunch of measurements, you want to actually know, have a ground truthing. This is the ground truthing device, but we've also increased the speed of this to make it something that actually can be used for slower phenomics measurements. So we're talking about a 30-second measurement per leaf, and so it's now realistic to actually go out in the field and make hundreds of measurements within a day. You're not going to do a genomic screen at that kind of speed, but you can definitely do a secondary screen or look at specific genotypes of interest. And we just recently published a brand new method called RACER. And so this is a new technique to look at biochemistry. So within plants, there's a CO2 response. Photosynthesis increases with increasing CO2. And that response is a fairly slow response to look at the biochemistry in vivo. This new approach takes that same measurement of biochemistry, so we still measure the velocity of carboxylation, the efficiency of Rubisco, but we compress that down into 10 minutes versus the 45 to 50 minutes necessary using the traditional method. So once again, it's not 10-second measurements, but now we're looking at biochemistry in 10 minutes, so we're compressing and changing that venue of phenomics. And so with that, I'll turn it over.
Yeah, thanks, Pat. And again, please write down your questions or comments, and we'll open the floor up at the end of the presentation. It's Yufeng. The title of his contribution is Engineering Sensing and Robotic Systems for Automated Plant Phenotyping.
Hi, so again, thanks Archie for the introduction. I'm an ag engineer, so I'm trained as an engineer. So I found out that this plant phenomics and plant phenomics and genomics really, or in addition to all other wonderful things doing that, also provide a really nice opportunity for the engineers being able to collaborate with the wonderful plant scientists, plant physiologists and breeders and such to do wonderful things. So my presentation today is gonna be this is actually a little bit different. Advanced imaging for phenotyping water-related crop traits. I wanted to be a little bit more relevant to water and food. First of all, I wanted to show you a cartoon here. So basically, it really shows you the power of the automated high-throughput phenotyping system and what that can do. So as you can see, on the left top is the raw plant image, and on the right is what we go through the image processing, being able to extract the plant pixels. And then on down on the bottom there, it's actually a growth curve that we can draw over the course of roughly 25 days. And you can see at the end, we derive this really nice exponential growth curve. And from there, you can extract a lot of things like dynamics, plant properties, such as relative growth rate. So this is really the power of the system. Is usually when you look at the plant traits, you always get a terminal measurement. But in use a system like this, and if you go the sequence, that you can actually grab a lot of dynamic properties that is usually harder to get from conventional methods. So I'm going to talk about the measurement of three water-related crop traits today. Evapotranspiration, water use efficiency, and the leaf water content. So this experiment is actually, I collaborate with Dr. James Schnable here. So we pick two maize genotypes that are the most common ones, B73, and the mini maize is another maize genetics that isn't used quite a bit in the field. So we have a total of 80 plants on the belt. And then we subject them to two water treatments. So one well water treatment, and the other is a water-limited treatment. And then we put the plants on the conveyor belt for 21 days 3 weeks continuous imaging with two imaging modules, an RGB and a hyperspectral camera. And then, so I also have a cartoon here, which is very similar to what Dr. Archie just showed. And basically it shows the automatic watering and weighing station. And this is a really useful feature because that allows us to track very accurately the water consumption of each plant every day. And then from there, because the cartoon that you see before allows us to actually calculate the plant dry matter every day very accurately. So from there, we can actually calculate what is the water use efficiency. And finally, I will show you how to use some of the results that we use, we got to measure leaf water content from hyperspectral imaging. Would you please show this? It's very similar, but this is, I believe this is actually the sorghum plants. But it comes out of the imaging module, and then it will be transported to a automated watering station. And from there, so we will set a targeted watering rate every day. And then you can see, so there's a scale down there that measures the current weight. And then the water will be added to a target weight that we set. And then the cycle will be repeated the next day. That you can imagine that, you know, from there that we can calculate the so the evapotranspiration very accurately every day. Okay. So this just to kind of give you a visual comparison of the two corn plants. They are at the exact growth stage, and one is well watered, and the other is water deficient, and you can see how morphologically they look different, right? So this one on the right here is very much water stressed, and you can almost see the leaf rolling and all those symptoms that you typically see in the field. So here's I will skip a lot of the analysis in the middle, but I will jump right into the results here. So this chart shows the evaporation that we calculated as a function of time, and we group those observations by plant genotypes and by the treatment. So you can see those circles are from one plant genotype, and the crosses from another genotype, and then the color coding tells you the water treatment. And you can see that those are really, so as the time goes by, those early evapotranspiration, there's no difference between the treatment, between the genotype. Those are the evapotranspiration is mainly determined by the greenhouse environment because the plants are fairly small by the time. But as we go by, you can see they start to diverge. And one thing that really caught us is the evapotranspiration is really determined by the treatment. So the more water you gave, so disregard the genotypes, that those receive well water treatment will consume more water as they goes by. Now, if you compare this result to this next slide, which shows you the variation of water use efficiency, and you can see the water use efficiency is actually determined by the genotype. So you can see that those circles are grouped together and those crosses are grouped together. So when we look at those, compare those two charts, it's a pretty amazing to us that the system being able to pick up to quantify the difference in water use efficiency because of the difference in genotypes. And then finally, I wanted to look at the plant hyperspectral images. So I put it here because hyperspectral imaging, we talk them a lot, but it seems to be a mystery for a lot of you. But hyperspectral imaging is just the extension of RGB images. So RGB, you got three bands, but hyperspectral imaging, you have densely sampled image bands across wavelengths domain. You do this for hundreds of bands. And you can see that this is an example of hyperspectral imaging again, this is actually sorghum plants. But you can see how the plants would look differently from all those wave bands. And you know, if you look at each of those pixels in the plants, you can actually draw a spectrum out of it. And so the number of data or number of information you get from hyperspectral imaging is way more than what you can get from the RGB camera. And also, so these two are two examples. So this blue curve is the leaf spectra, the spectra from the leaf pixels. And the red down here is the spectra from the stem. And you can see how different they are. Even though if you look at the RGB image, they are very similar to each other. So hyperspectral imaging allows you to do a lot of analysis, including like machine, you can apply them to machine learning, to multivariate statistical analysis, just because the number of information you get is so much more than the regular RGB images. So from here, we can actually predict the leaf water content. So how do we do that? So basically, we take the hyperspectral imaging of the images of the plants, and then after that, we subject all those plants to destructive analysis. We harvest them, and then we put them in the oven to get the water the leaf water content, and then we use the spectra to develop a model to predict the water content, actual water content from the lab analysis. And we do this actually pretty rigorously, so we separate them into a calibration set, and we separate them into a validation set. And this result here is what you see is from the validation set. And you can see that the R-square, we do actually run two analyses. So we have an R-square of 0.97 for the first analysis. And then the second analysis involves two plant types. So we have a maize and we have a soybean, and the R-square is 0.93. So this tells us that hyperspectral imaging possibly can be a non-destructive measure to measure leaf water content non-destructively, very fast, so that you know if you wanted to screen for that traits, you can use the hyperspectral imaging to do that, potentially. So this comes to my last slide. So a couple of challenges from greenhouse to field. Yes, the system is great, you know, measures things very accurately, but we do have challenges. So the first challenge that I see is really the scaling from plot to field. So we can do this very precisely for individual plants on a pot level, but when you move to the field, this is really from to a plot or the entire field level, then our hands are tied for a lot of things that we can do. And instrumentation, which is my expertise area, is one thing. You know, you wouldn't expect the performance of the camera is the same in greenhouse as opposed to in the field. So I do a lot of research just trying to keep, you know, how do we develop the systems so that we can still make camera useful in the field. That's, you know, one of the bigger research area that in my group. And also this interaction between genes and the environments and the management is really a huge thing. That's a huge unknown out there that we're trying to address. So I put those three slides here. So that's the ARD's new field phenotyping facility. And this is the field phenotyping cards that developed from my group trying to address that measurement at the plot level. And finally, UAV would play a really significant role later on. And with that, I will stop my presentation.
Thanks.
And we will give you plenty of chance to interact with the panel after these presentations. There's one chair up here, I guess. Addie, the floor is yours, addressing the challenges of global agriculture using advanced plant traits.
Great, thank you for inviting me. Being the outside person, this is a really fantastic opportunity. That was a really good preface, I think, to what I'm gonna talk about, because everything I'll be presenting is entirely field-based. So I'm the only field-based person, I think. So I'm primarily a quantitative geneticist, but I've gotten the opportunity at Purdue to work with a lot of different researchers and groups. That is not my talk. Thompson. Give a preview.
Let's see what you can do with the presentation.
I mean, I could try, but so I'll be talking about a number of advanced plant traits, including some high throughput phenotyping, but a few other things as well. So you know, the grand challenge of agriculture is that we want to double our food, feed, fiber, and fuel under climate change while being responsible to our land use, obviously, and to the ecosystem. So doing this in an economically viable, socially responsible way, but in order to enable food security. So that's the perspective I come from. And there's a few ways that, as plant scientists, we can work to adapt to climate change. One is to develop varieties of target crops that can improve, that have improved adaptation to climate change. So heat-resistant genotypes is something that we work on. We've got a project that works on heat-tolerant maize for Southeast Asia. Drought-tolerant maize is another project. And then high-throughput phenotyping in sorghum. So those are all ways that we can improve crops, basically, by changing the genetics. Other things that you can do is to change the crop species. So for example, sorghum requires a lot less water to grow than maize. So if there's regions of Africa that use maize as a forage crop, or even in the US use maize as a forage crop, instead of creating drought tolerant maize for those regions, one useful approach is to switch to sorghum. So you're using a lot less water. A negative thing that comes with that is sorghum, when it's macerated at a young age, can release chemicals that turn into cyanide and can kill cattle. So another thing our lab works on, obviously that's very bad, another thing our lab works on is creating durin-free sorghum that enables sorghum to not release cyanide, because it does not have the precursors that lead to the cyanide gas production. So that's another important area of research that we do. And then another thing that you can do is modify the crop management. So obviously you're leveraging not just genetics, but also environment and management, so changing planting dates, tillage, double cropping, et cetera, lots of different approaches. I just have a short time, so I'm going to focus on the things that I do in the lab, which are the drought-tolerant maize project and the high-throughput phenotyping in sorghum, so those two listed in blue. So to give a little bit of background, there was a project a number of years ago that was funded by a combination of the Gates and Buffett Foundations, as well as USAID and the UK International Development Group. And this was done at CIMMYT and IITA in collaboration, so in Mexico and Africa. This was a project that was to combine plant science approaches, plant breeding, as well as policy, training, and a number of capacity building types of projects. And so the goal was to increase yield in areas where there's a lot of risk of drought. And so the idea was that you want to increase yield under drought, but not lose any of your drought under well-watered conditions, obviously. This project was quite successful. They released a number of varieties. There's tens of millions of people now that are growing these varieties, and it's really benefiting their fields. This project finished up in 2015. But the brilliant thing is that for plant scientists, now there's this whole collection of drought-tolerant maize that we can leverage for the what we call germplasm. So the varieties, the genetic varieties that have been created by these plant breeders, now we can use for our projects. So capturing diversity for crop improvement. My main project, one of my main projects, starts with these elite tropical lines. So they're developed for, you know, high heat, high moisture types of environments, but drought prone areas. So this is the DTMA material out of public breeding programs, CIMMYT mostly. And then we're also leveraging an equal number of elite temperate lines. So these come from a panel that we call XPVP, which stands for Expired Plant Variety Protection. And what it is when a company like Pioneer, Monsanto, Syngenta, whoever, releases lines, they do so under a license called Plant Variety Protection. After some number of years, that expires. And so what we can do is we can harvest those lines, not literally speaking, but metaphorically. We can mine that material and, you know, sequence the genetics and look at how they perform to take advantage of that material. So I'm using both of those panels and crossing them to a couple of common testers we call testers. What this means, corn is something that we grow as hybrids. You've probably heard of corn hybrids before. What that means is we take two different inbreds, which are different from each other, we cross them together, and then the offspring is way better than either of the parents, right? We call that heterosis. So testing them as hybrids under both drought and well-watered conditions. How do we do that? Well, we grow it in the desert, and then we irrigate it to the extent that we choose. So this is taking diverse elite material, not, you know, ancient inbreds that have been used historically, so current elite material from two different sets of germplasm from both public and private industry, tropical and temperate lines, excuse me, evaluating them as hybrids, and under relevant field conditions, so this is relevant and economically important material under important conditions. So the goals here become, first of all, to characterize these lines and their response to drought, and then also to identify unique regions of the genome that might be beneficial for improving maize. The idea being that if we have some material that has regions with positive contribution, and then we have another set of material that has different regions of positive contributions, we can combine those to get even better material than what we could have gotten from either population individually. And so the idea is that using these two sets of germplasm together, we can make improvements that will not only benefit farmers and growers and researchers in the US, but also in Africa and Southeast Asia, all across the globe, right? So using the temperate material to improve the tropical material and vice versa. How did we do this? We took a number of phenotypes in sort of a low-tech way. First, we took flowering nodes, morphology, what we call stay green. This is a measure of chlorophyll using a chlorophyll meter. So we clamp it on the leaf. It tells us how much greenness there is. The idea being that a plant that stays greener longer into a drought period is not reacting as strongly to the drought as something that's able to that turns green or turns brown senesces right away. So something that dries out slower. And then, of course, some yield components, so looking at the productivity. We also look at a number of slightly stranger traits, things like leaf stomata. So stomata are like the little pores within the leaves of the plant that let air and gas exchange. Leaf membrane lipid composition. So if you think about butter under heat, the butter changes from being a solid to a liquid. The same kind of thing sort of happens with leaf membrane lipids. So you want something that maintains some structure under heat and it doesn't just wilt right away. And also carbon and nitrogen isotope ratio. So these things are related to drought response and water use efficiency. Now, these are all great traits and we can get a lot of information here, but the problem is obviously a lot of it is manual and it's very slow and laborious. So this is sort of the impetus for moving into things like automated crop phenotyping, which you've already heard a little bit about. The project that I am working on that works with high throughput phenotyping, I know this is kind of small text, I work at Purdue University, but we work in conjunction with IBM Research and also the University of Queensland. So we're combining expertise in remote sensing technologies and digital sensing information, as well as statistical modeling and also crop modeling. The platforms that we use, we have a modified high-boy sprayer that we use. We call it our Pheno Rover, there on the left. So that has a custom boom on the front that has a number of sensors mounted, and then that drives physically through the field. We also have several UAVs that are rotowing type, and then several fixed wing aircraft as well. So the fixed wing can take a slightly higher payload, which is why we use those. And they're also a little bit safer for really expensive sensors. If you have a rotorcraft that fails, it just drops like a rock, whereas a fixed wing can kind of glide down. So if we have, tens of thousands of dollars worth of instrumentation on there, sometimes it's a bit safer to put it on the fixed wing. So some of the sensors we use here pictured are what we call a LIDAR, hyperspectral, and then an RGB camera. A LIDAR, if you haven't heard of it, it has multiple lasers that are scanning constantly like this in a circle. And what that does is those laser beams go and hit objects and bounce off, and it measures the return. So what you end up getting is sort of a 3D picture of whatever it is it's scanning. It's actually really interesting if you haven't seen it before, but it creates like a little point cloud of the structure of what you're looking at. So you can get a number of geometric shapes of the plant just based on where that laser hits. In conjunction with all of this cool aerial data, we also have to do a lot of ground validation. So thank you, Pat, for bringing that up. Ground validation is never all that fun. So we go in and we regularly, on a timed basis, go in and cut out giant sections of our plots, and we weigh those bundles, and we have to go through and do biomass harvest. So what we do is we have a calibration set and we have a training set. Our calibration set consists of very large 12-row plots that are probably half the size of this room approximately, but that allows us to go in and take our destructive harvest measurements while still maintaining portions of the plot that we can fly over. So we're not ruining the material that we would be trying to get traits out of. We also, so we cut plants out as well, And we take a lot of measurements on each individual plant, several per plot. We also lay them out on boards and take pictures of them and take pictures of the panicle. Then all the material gets weighed and then dried and then reweighed, so we get a lot of the water measurements as well. That's an awful lot of work, and we'd like to not have to do that. So that's why we're working to calibrate our models so that we can do this all from the sky. So what does it look like when we take these traits from the sky? The first thing you need to do is a lot of corrections and data processing, right? So the pre-processing is pretty extensive. And the first thing you've got to do is know where your drone is at, right? So get really good GPS data and get all of that integrated across all of your sensors. And so what you can see here is a view of, I'm not covering the laser beam, what you can see here is a flyover of a region between fields, like this drone is doing now. And you see these panels that are set out. That's what you see, these little dots here. So this is actually some LIDAR calibrations. This is a really dense point cloud you're seeing. But these little panels here are the little panels that are out here in the field. So it's making sure that they're lining up and you're actually getting the right view. This is another example of that. So you're looking at like a light pole, essentially. If you don't have well-calibrated LIDAR, then as you drive forward and backward and drive past the same object several times, it doesn't geolocate to the same location. So this is an example of calibrating so that our light pole becomes a light pole instead of spikes. similarly, we have RGB targets that we set out in the field. So this is for, you know, geometric calibration. When you get a picture from a drone, you're getting a picture from, you know, anywhere from 150 to 400 feet probably, and what you see is kind of a fisheye effect. It's pretty skewed, and so there's a lot of geometric correction that goes into making what we call these orthophotos. So this giant photo of these several fields, that's actually hundreds and hundreds of images that have been pieced together. And what we do is we put out a number of these targets in the field, and we can see those from the sky, and then we can create test and training targets in the field to make sure that we're actually getting appropriate accuracy. That allows us to measure what our accuracy is. And what we get is about 2 centimeter accuracy in the X, Y, and Z direction, which people say, if you're taking pictures from the sky, if this is just RGB, how do you get Z? Well, what happens is when the plane flies over, you're getting about 60 to 70% overlap in the images. And so you're actually getting the same picture of each pixel from multiple directions. And so that allows us to estimate not only its point in the plane this way, but also this way. And so we're about 2 centimeter accuracy in any given direction for each pixel. And then we also have developed a stepwise orthorectification. This is actually a hyperspectral image, but it's showing you, you know, the green visible bands out of the hyperspectral image. But this is showing some of our stepwise orthorectification, where we go from having these horribly skewed images that I talked about to, you know, rectifying them once and then finally making sure that the rows are straight and it's actually rectified how it's supposed to be. So we're currently developing this platform in sorghum because that's where the project was created, but the plans are to apply these approaches to that maize population that I just talked about. And so that will help us to leverage these approaches into an agronomically relevant situation that applies to global drought tolerance, which is what's exciting to me. So the idea is that we're taking a lot of high throughput traits. Things that we can currently measure pretty accurately are things like the plant location and spacing. That doesn't sound very exciting and interesting, but actually in sorghum, you plant about this far apart at an agronomic density. They're really close together. So seeing where those plants are when they're that close is actually kind of tricky. Counting leaves from the sky, canopy cover percentage, plant height, lodging. We had a really interesting lodging event last summer, which can be bad, but it also provides an opportunity for us to look at that as a trait. So if you don't know, lodging is when the plant falls over, right? So we had a big windstorm that came through. You can either have stuff that snaps like this, or it can just completely fall over at the roots. And there's some material that does that and some that doesn't, but that is actually interesting to see what does and what doesn't. Also panicle counting, so the grain on sorghum grows at the top, that's called the panicle. Greenness and stay green, which I talked about earlier. And then also latent feature extraction and machine learning. So this is pulling out traits that we don't know about, essentially. So as a person that works on plant science, I can think, okay, these are some agronomically relevant traits that I can think of. But what other traits could there be that I don't even know about that would be predictive of things like biomass or yield or drought response? It's good to go about it in a way that you're not biasing your results if you're, you know, trying to do some trait exploration. So we take these traits, we use various statistical approaches, including predictive modeling, crop modeling, and genomic prediction. I want to point out that crop modeling is especially important here because we're hoping to apply this to regions that are more drought prone in different regions of the world. So taking into account things like the environment, the weather, the soil conditions, that sort of thing, that's where the crop modeling becomes hugely important. So this allows us to increase the accuracy of our predictions, observe more individuals because you can get through more material, predict across multiple environments, including future climate change, enabling precision farming and land management, resource conservation. Those are things I didn't talk about, but this also is applicable there. And also getting more time points, which is huge. You can only destructively harvest so many times before you've destroyed your field. So getting multiple time points is also important. And in the end, what we're working to do is to create optimized crop varieties and production systems for food on a global scale. And this is not something we're alone in. So Purdue University has really put an emphasis on this idea of smarter agriculture, more efficient crop improvement and agronomic research platforms. And so what's happening is that Purdue is turning its entire field site into a high-throughput phenotyping precision agricultural zone. And we're going to be flying the whole field once a week and collecting measurements for the researchers there. And I think that's fantastic, and it's great to see that Purdue is putting a strong emphasis into this approach. The field component is one large part of it. We also have a really high-tech greenhouse that's being built, and we also have a tower and another greenhouse. So we'll have a few different approaches that researchers can use to get at these questions. So the idea is using automated phenotyping technologies based on these airborne and ground-based sensor systems in order to enable gene discovery and optimization of crop varieties and production systems for food production. And the idea is then that we'll be building these models and learning how to do some of this analysis in, you know, Purdue and in the US and at our field sites here. But using our predictive abilities and crop modeling, we can apply this to regions like Africa and Southeast Asia, where the need for this kind of prediction and crop improvement is vastly needed. This is a nutritional deficiencies map. If you plotted out drought stress, it would look largely the same as a heat map, probably not by coincidence. So with that, thank you. I'm happy to take questions later.
Thanks, James Schnable. The role of high-throughput phenotyping and plant breeding.
Yeah. All right, so I've been editing my talk as these presentations have been going on, because I think a lot of the concepts are being covered already, which is wonderful, actually.
And yours is the one that hasn't been up on the screen.
Yeah. Anyway, so as I was putting this talk together, the thing that really occurred to me is, I mean, a lot of you folks are probably not plant breeders. For those of you who work with plant breeding, this is going to be very much review. But why are we having a session on high-throughput phenotyping and plant breeding at the Water for Food conference this year? And the real reason for that is that, wonderful. Oh, and before I start, it has been determined that I should disclose that I have significant equity interests in two startups, DataToBio and Dryland Genetics. And there's a more detailed disclosure on my website if you are concerned about this in any way. So, I'm going to start with a couple of things that we already know. The first is that, at least in the U.S. and in large other parts of the world, agricultural productivity is now more constrained by water availability than land availability. I started at the University of Nebraska about 3 years ago, and one of the great things we do here is they take all the young faculty, they put them on a bus, and they drive them all the way out to the west end of the state and back. They call it the Rhodes Scholar Tour. I developed two of the collaborations that I really enjoyed here. I met Yufeng for the first time on that tour, and we got out to Scotts Bluff, and I met Deepak Santra, who's in back there, who is one of the only breeders for Proso Millet anywhere in the world. But what made this made very apparent is as you get farther and farther out in the state, you start to see more and more barren land. And it's not barren because we can't, the soil is bad, it's barren because we don't have the water to grow water-intensive crops like maize on that land. We also know that there's a lot of variation in the efficiency with which different grain crops convert water into grain. Now this is replotted data from a paper that's more than a century old. So for a very long time we've had the ability to make these measurements of water use and then the corresponding amount of grain produced by different plants. We haven't followed up on it because just measuring this, you know, these small handful of plants was an entire project for a USDA postdoc or probably a graduate student many, many years ago when the USDA had a lot more funding. High throughput phenotyping, though, allows us to make these same measurements on a larger scale. So this is data from Jakai Lang, who's a PhD student in my lab. And one of the first things that we did when the high throughput phenotyping greenhouse came online across the street was run a series of maize inbreds through there to measure the efficiency, the ratio of the ability, the water transpired to biomass produced. So this is a follow-up to that wonderful paper that we had the chance to work on with the GID lab. And what you see is that there is actually a lot of variation even within a single crop.
Can you speak up a bit?
Oh, okay. So what you see is there's actually a lot of variation even within a single crop. And the other interesting thing, so as Addie or Dr. Thompson mentioned, there are a number of these lines that are XPVP. So these are lines that were developed relatively recently by the seed companies and have recently come off patent, as well as much older lines developed in the public sector. If you see anything that starts with an LH or a PH, that's probably an XPVP line. And we see that those are distributed pretty broadly across this graph. So there's been a lot of breeding in corn, but it hasn't really altered the water use efficiency of this crop. The other thing we know, though, is that breeding is a very powerful tool to change phenotype. I'm sure almost everyone in the audience has seen some version of this slide, which shows the change in average yield from cornfields over the last 150 years. And what you see is for a long time it was flat until we developed the ability to work with double cross and then single cross hybrids, and then yields accelerated radically. We also know that selecting for any phenotype, whether it's yield or water use efficiency, is getting more expensive. So this is some of the same data from just the last 50 or 60 years. And what it shows is that we, both the public and private sector, are spending exponentially more money to get that same linear increase in yield every year. And this is just yield. We're not even talking about selecting for water use efficiency yet. So we have a problem. Now, how does selection work? You can think of selection as operating in cycles. So we have a set of candidate lines. We evaluate those lines. We say some are either higher yielding or more efficient at using water or both. Select those lines, intercross them again, get a new set of candidate lines, and back through the cycle. So depending on the generation time, with some crops you can do six of these a year. With some crops like trees, you can do maybe six of these in your lifetime. Now if we want to accelerate the rate of genetic gain, either increasing yield more or increasing yield at the same time selecting for increased water use efficiency, we need a way to improve this process. And this, there will not be a quiz on this equation, but this is how we can actually calculate the rate of that increase in gain. Going through that equation, there are basically three levers we can push. The first is to increase the speed of the breeding cycle. So run more cycles of selection, getting the same amount of gain from each. I'm not going to be talking about that today. The other two are either to select from bigger populations. So if I select the highest performing line from 10,000 lines, that's going to tend to show a bigger increase in whatever trait I'm looking at than if I can only evaluate 100 lines. The second way is to actually increase the accuracy of selection. So generally, right now, the way we select for high performing lines is we grow them in the field with test plots. We measure the yield. Often that yield is coming from maybe 72 plants. And if you get a bad measurement, you know, that first year, maybe you were planted in a low-lying area and it wasn't corrected for in the model, that line gets thrown out, even if there's a great deal of yield potential there. Both of these second two points have the potential to be improved through the use of high-throughput phenotyping, which allows us to start selecting for traits in addition to yield without giving up that linear increase in yield that is so of value both to farmers and consumers. So what is high-throughput phenotyping? It is essentially anything that is not shown in this slide. So the definition I like to use is that if I can send a graduate student into the field with a yardstick or a protractor, that's not high-throughput phenotyping. The rest of the stuff is high-throughput. As Archie already reviewed, we are building both this field-based system and a greenhouse-based system here. The greenhouse-based system has been online for several years. You've already heard about the wonderful things that can be done with hyperspectral data to measure plant composition in a non-destructive fashion so that we can look at changes throughout the entire cycle of development, which again gives us the potential to increase accuracy because we're not just looking at that terminal endpoint, we're able to look at that whole curve. Similarly with RGB data, I've been working with a lot of computer scientists, not just to look at the overall number of pixels of the plant, but to teach them to understand what are the different organs of the plant and to do things that are very easy for a human but very difficult for a computer. For example, these are two photos of the same corn plant taken in two sequential days, and knowing that this is still the second leaf even though the first leaf has died overnight. To a human, that's very easy. To a computer, it is surprisingly difficult. Yes. Once we can do that, that allows us to track the extension of each leaf over time, which is very valuable because one of the first indicators of stress when a plant doesn't have enough water, doesn't have enough nutrition, doesn't have enough sunlight, is that it stops producing new tissue, which is a very energetically expensive process. So this allows us to have more sensitive and earlier markers for when our plants are beginning to get stressed. Now, the thing, again, this is something that we've heard from several previous talks. The thing I really wish I'd known before I got into high-throughput phenotyping is that it doesn't actually decrease the workload in conventional phenotyping. It increases it because now you need all of these ground truth measurements in order to develop the computational approaches. The corollary of this is that if you want to build the community, you want to build more tools for actually extracting numerical measurements from RGB images, from hyperspectral data, the most valuable thing that you can do is produce data sets of agronomically relevant lines where you have both the high-throughput phenotyping data and the ground truth data, throw that open to the community and say, hey, can you predict some of these from some of those? And so that's what we've been doing here at the University of Nebraska. I've been very fortunate to have support, internal support, to use the greenhouse across the street. And we've been growing common sets of inbreds and hybrids from these XPVP lines. I like to describe these are as close as I can legally get to the corn that's growing in Nebraska cornfields right now. And collaborating with people all over the U.S. who are growing the same common set of lines in different environments, collecting lots of environmental and soil data, as well as agronomic phenotypes. And the hope is that this will allow us to build the models for what can we predict from the hyperspectral data, from the RGB data, about how plants will perform in different environments. With the ultimate goal that we want to grow crops, whether those are new hybrids of maize or other grain crops that have already been developed but haven't gone through that same exponential increase in yield that we've seen in maize in the last 50 years, that will grow in land, marginal land, where corn fails without irrigation. So I really like this photo. This is actually from Deepak's field a few years ago out by Scott's Bluff. And this is the row of corn that he grew. One of the plants managed to make a tassel. I think everything else died. And then the other more water use efficient grain crops on either side that are just perfectly happy in this otherwise very marginal land. With that, I'm very fortunate, both in the people I work in my lab. I joke that I'm a professional token plant biologist because I get invited to all these meetings with lots of engineers and statisticians, and my job is to speak up and say, sorghum plants don't actually have tassels, that sort of thing. I've been also been fortunate in my support both from federal sources, from commodity boards, and from private industry. And with that, I would be happy to hand it over to my last colleague who's speaking.
Thanks, guys. Dr. Walia. Image-based phenomics approach for elucidating water stress response in crops.
Gotcha. I think I'm going to wait another 10 seconds to see if it goes up. Okay. All right. So today I'm going to talk a little bit about how you've learned about the resources that we're using in Nebraska and in Purdue, and the methods and the equipment that's being developed. So I'm going to try and focus on how we can use that to go all the way to gene discovery. And the reason we want to do that is because lots of times we talk about drought, but what we do sometimes we do forget that not only the water quantity, which is drought stress here, but also the quality of water can impact crop productivity. So you could have a too much water, for instance, in this flooded field, or very little water in the middle, or you could have a highly saline field. So even though, you know, salt stress is considered, you know, sometimes separately, but from a physiological perspective, it's quite, and from also from an agronomic perspective, it's quite overlapping. For instance, in, you know, in rice fields in parts of Asia during the dry season, you could have very little rainfall. So because of the drought, you do end up accumulating high amounts of salt in the soil. So in the wet season, the salt gets, you know, drained out or, you know, into the lower parts of the soil, so the plants would do better. So my lab's interest is in understanding, you know, what's the physiological basis of the stress responses around water, and what's the genetic basis that drive many of these physiological responses. So to give you like a salt stress 101, basically this is on y-axis is your growth rate, and when you apply the salt and you're tracking, you know, the growth rate here in green, once you do apply salt stress, initially most plants would almost stop growing, you know, right away, and then they recover. So the initial phase, which is called the osmotic phase, is very similar to what the plants would experience under drought stress. Perhaps the rate is slightly different. The second phase is when in the ionic phase, where the plants you know, are actually experiencing stress, not only because of lack of their ability to draw water from the soil, but also the sodium and other ions, whatever is contributing to high salt, is accumulating and causing a toxic effect. So your plants start to change color and, you know, pigments start to degrade and so on. So there's different mechanisms that have been known to contribute to either one of those, but and that's been known for, you know, 20, 30 years. But what really phenomics can help us drive is the genetic basis of those responses. Previously, if you were to try and take a population, let's say 200 different genotypes, which are basically slightly variant or hugely variant genetic makeup, so those are genotypes, and you try to sample growth every day, you'd be sampling thousands of plants, and the accuracy would also be low. But with approaches such as phenomics, we can actually go in and start to measure those traits without destroying the plants. So that's what, you know, what we are doing in our lab is we think of it in terms of a layered cake, and it's not unidirectional. So you have the gene space where we are trying to predict what kind of changes in the DNA sequence will result in differences in response to a stress, whether it's a drought stress or a water stress or a salt stress. We look at the gene space through association analysis, and then we also want to look at the genes express themselves as transcripts and then proteins. So we want to look also at the gene networks, because proteins don't work by themselves most of the time. They work in a social environment equivalent to like your humans. And they also, so what are those, what are those mechanisms? And then finally the phenomics space, where we're using opticals, you know, we've seen examples of, the optical phenomics, and then biochemical as well as physical measurements, and then being able to connect this across, across different levels to DNA sequences, with the idea that can we discover genes that would make crops more drought tolerant or salt tolerant. And so for today's talk, I'm going to focus more on the association that we have been making with the image data and the DNA sequence differences. I will kind of bring in a couple of points where we're using information that we've already generated, although I won't talk about how we did it from the transcript space over here. So we used a rice diversity panel, which is a collection of about 400 rice lines from all over the world, with the idea being that can we actually see how different they are when they respond to, for instance, drought stress or salt stress. So in this case, we've screened for salt tolerance or salt response, and, you know, Archie's already described some of the setups of, you know, how we can generate millions of images for an experiment like that by capturing the dynamic response of plant growth or changes in pigmentation of the leaf over time. So the component that we're really leveraging here is not only the sensitivity to pick up small differences, but also be able to do it over a time course. So you could have two plants that look equally miserable at the end of a long stress treatment, but their trajectories might be completely different. Can we actually discover any DNA features, changes in DNA that can be associated with those different dynamics, even though the endpoints are different? So that's the kind of questions that we want to answer with this approach. So we did that, and here's a box plot that shows you in the gray is the salt stress. So these are days for imaging, and these are pixel count, which kind of correlate with the growth rate or the addition of biomass. And this system works well, as you know, Yufeng's shown, and also with the ground truthing, that this is a good method for measuring changes in biomass. And what we saw is that even with the 400 genotypes, there are about 400 genotypes that we were using, 2-3 days after the addition of the final salt level, we started to see differences in growth. And these are, you know, pretty hard to pick, even if you were looking there, staring for several days that early. So they're very sensitive. So this is how we kind of define. So some genotypes that don't show, so you have a salt index, so some genotypes that don't show much of a response or drop in growth rate kind of belong here. And so one of those is Kihogo, it's African rice. And the other genotypes that are very sensitive have a very low ratio. So those would be something like the Gweha 3, which is a Korean rice line. So to kind of plot just these two extremes, this is what it looks like. This is their growth response, and these are is days over imaging. And as you can see, the sensitive line, the one in the red, starts to drop its growth rate even before you reach the final salt levels. So there's great sensitivity in separating different genotypes that have a slightly or hugely different genetic makeup when it comes to their response to salt stress. So then, you know, Addie mentioned about these extracting these latent features or phenotypes that we don't know about what they really mean, but they are very, but you could do it through image analysis. So one instance of that we used was from the fluorescence imaging system. So in fluorescence images would capture the intensity of the light bouncing off of pigments. And so if you have chlorophyll or a yellowing leaf, you're gonna get a slightly different image signature compared to a very dark green, you know, healthy leaf. So we looked at at those images, and we asked if there were big changes. Yes, there were some plants that were slightly, you know, definitely more yellow than the others. But what we went after was that could we define the specific bandwidth or the range of the intensity for that particular colors, for instance, red color, and then see if there's any differences. So we found some pretty neat changes in pigmentation. So we have those bins, and this is just a heat map showing you that we can start to pick changes in pigmentation, even though visually you cannot, but from your imaging, as early as 6 days. So the power of the association analysis and the idea that we have all that DNA sequence information for those 400 lines kind of help us determine what this may be eventually, like, you know, what's the biochemical or the genetic basis for this difference that we're seeing here. So kind of revisiting, so what I described to you is this imaging part. So next, we worked with, you know, statisticians and quantitative geneticists to kind of link these changes here that we were seeing with DNA sequence differences. So this was done through modeling, so I'm not going to spend too much time working on that. But I wanted to make this crazy hair plot. So I'm trying to make a point is that on. So just to walk you through. So on this is the days on the x-axis, both, and on the y-axis is your ratio. So the growth curve ratio for salt to control. So from the beginning of the stress, you would expect that, you know, the salt stress would impact the growth rate, so the growth curve describing would go down. So what those two different colors mean is that if we go to each land milestone sequence difference in the rice genome, and we ask whether having a sequence which is having one sequence versus the other sequence, so whether having those differences in sequences are called alleles, so having a blue allele versus a red allele would make a difference in the response curve. So what we have here is that we found some DNA sequence differences that would if you all the genotypes in the panel that had the blue allele had a mean response curve like this, and the others that didn't have that one had the red allele had the mean response curve shown here. So what it does show is that we can pinpoint changes in DNA sequence that associate, that may or may not be causing it, but they associate with how those genotypes respond to stress, whether it's a very early separation in very sharp decrease in growth rate here and not so much in the blue case, or initially they are acting fairly similarly but only start to separate later on. So the dynamics of the trait. So you may think of it as a marathon where two racers reach the same time, but one person might have a very fast start and then he or she tapers down, and the other one kind of is slow to begin but can maintain. It has had greater stamina. So the genetics that drives those two things, or the physiology underlying those two human bodies, would be actually quite different. So that's basically what we're trying to determine here. And so that resulted in us looking at the landscape of the rice genome. It has 12 chromosomes, but basically we decide on a threshold, and all the DNA markers or milestones that we see above that threshold as being significant. So we basically found pretty good markers, one on chromosome 3. Each chromosome is shown in alternating black and gray colors. And then we also found an interesting one on chromosome 1. The one we think on chromosome 1 is actually really interesting, because not only did we see it for growth that I showed you, but also for fluorescence. So this location, this basically a distance location on the chromosome of 1. And so this marker here, about between 25 and 30 megabase pair, is associated both with the growth response as well as the fluorescence, so the more of the ionic response. What we also did, as I mentioned briefly early on, is that we also sequenced the active part of the genome, which is called the RNA pool or the transcriptome, for about 100 of these lines for rice. And we use those as intermediate phenotypes. So not only phenotypes from the images, but actually using the abundance of transcripts from all those 100 lines to see if we can associate that. So we found EQTL, or that's basically the expression-based mapping of traits. So we found about 35 genes that were really significant. And one of the most significant gene is TPC1, which has a high probability for expression as well as for accumulation of sodium, so more of an ionic stress. So we focused on that, and here's a graph that shows the so this is just the zoom in off of that location that I mentioned. Here's a graph that shows the SNPs, or the DNA markers that are associated with SHOOT, sodium and potassium, in light blue. And then with the transcript abundance for the TPC1, which is a channel that transmits calcium and has been known to be important for root to shoot signaling under salt stress and arabidopsis. So currently my lab's characterizing this gene through genome editing. So we are going in and precisely making sequence changes in the TPC1 to make it either look like the tolerant line or the tolerant accessions or the sensitive. We don't know which one is tolerant or sensitive, but more on the based on the transcript abundance. So knocking it down and also making it overly active to see whether this is truly a gene that drives growth and growth response and potentially, salt tolerance in rice genome. So, kind of just to summarize, taking the we see a lot of value in the capturing the dynamics that is probably only possible if you have non-destructive high-throughput phenomics approaches, and you have the genetics or the genomics to back it up, in the sense that you should be able to go in and precisely say, well, this DNA sequence or this gene is associated with this response, whether it's to drought tolerance or salt stress. And then given the new emerging technologies such as genome editing, you can now go in precisely and make changes that you think are optimal, and end up with a rice plant or a wheat plant or a corn plant that's not even genetically modified, according to, hopefully that would be a true statement in a few years. So these are people I work with. My PhD students have been the primary driver of this research. And if you have any
questions. Thank you. We have some time for questions. Any questions directly to the panel members based on their presentations or other questions?
Sure. Yeah. Thank you. So I'm S.K. Gupta. I'm pearl millet breeder from Ikrisat, India. So as a breeder of pearl millet crop, just brief you, pearl millet is one of the most drought-tolerant crops. It's the trait which is our first challenge, but least prioritized. Why? Because screening protocol is very weak, field aid. And this piece of information where we have expertise from engineers, where you say that you have scanners, you have these systems, image-driven systems, where you can capture these traits, which may be proxy traits for drought problems. And then we heard from breeders and then some biotechnologies that there is some linkages. So the point here is drought is a very complex challenge. It's not just in a controlled environment you investigate your material like we are doing in our experiments, very high G into E into M. So when you are standardizing these models, when you are standardizing these phenotypic protocols, how much emphasis is given on really G into E into M of the experiments so that we have a very high correlation? So first of all, I'd like to know, do you have any studies where you can share some of the correlations between your screening protocol and what is happening on ground? And how much emphasis is given on planning of experiments to account G into E into M so that we have very high correlation? Thank you.
So I think that's a very important question. And I think one of the reasons that drought tolerance is such a hard thing to get at is that there actually are completely different mechanisms of things that we would call drought tolerance. For example, if you have a drought once every 10 years, a line that has really deep roots is going to be wonderful. It's going to go down and get that lower soil moisture and it'll be fine. In an area that is perpetually arid, that's not a good strategy. That water's going to be exhausted and it's not going to be there the next year. So you need lines that are going to be more efficient in their water use. So part of the issue, I think, with this very low heritability is that we're looking at very different physiological processes and calling them all drought tolerance. Now the second part of your question about designing studies to actually look at these G by E, so I think this is one of the things that Genomes to Fields is doing, is that we are growing, you know, common sets of several hundred hybrids in many different environments all over the U.S. Some of those are, you know, without irrigation in central Nebraska, which is usually a very reliable drought. So I hope I'm going to be able to have some of those correlations for you in a couple of years as we screen those same lines in the high throughput phenotyping. At least in my lab, we're not there yet.
One of the things that our lab did in setting up our high-throughput phenotyping experiments was that we created different populations to target. And one, our calibration set was actually a set of commercial hybrid sorghum lines that are used for forages and grain and a number of other things. When James said he's using the closest thing to commercial that he can get legally, that's if you want to look at the genetics, that's true. We're not looking at any genetics in that population. We're growing things that farmers are growing in their fields. So we're using that to calibrate our statistical models in a way that will make them applicable to other things. And so we have two other populations we're using. One is a set of grain sorghum from Africa, and one is a set of bioenergy sorghum from the US. And so those are our large sets of material, 400 to 850 lines that we're using. So we're building our statistical models in something completely different, applying it to sets of material where we have a lot of genetics that allows us to link the genotype to phenotype. But in setting up the populations that way, it forces us to create models that are relevant to other types of material, as opposed to just within one experiment. And that is hugely important when it comes to things like drought, because when you're looking at drought, the heritabilities are terrible, right? I mean, if you're measuring a trait under well-watered conditions, you get something decent. If you look at it under drought, it drops a little bit. If you combine both heat and drought stress, your heritabilities are terrible. That's known, right? So we're hoping that by incorporating these technologies, we can increase that a little bit so that we're actually getting better and more information than we would doing it by hand. The other thing that we're doing is we're incorporating crop models into our analysis. So originally we're setting up our projects to work with the APSIM crop model. We're incorporating things like the environmental effects and the soil. However, if we're looking to parameterize those models using high throughput phenotypes, we're actually looking to distill those models down a bit. So I was talking to a potato breeder from Peru who was looking at, how to explain this, he basically is trying to recommend what varieties new breeders should start with across Peru, right? So they've got a number of field sites across Peru that they have, and they have grown a number of varieties. But what they can do then is they can create very simple crop models, and they can say, all right, with this type of potato, and there's, you know, a lot of different kinds of potato, but with this kind of potato, we see these responses in these environments. So we can say, all right, using the simple crop model, we can say, given your soil and environment conditions, this is the genetic material you should be starting with. And then you can leverage anything from there into high throughput phenomics, enabling your genomic prediction models. But I think that you're right that incorporating knowledge of the crop physiology, I think, is going to help with that question. Does that make sense? I hope. Anyone else?
So I think we're, you know, clearly the scale and the intensity and the infrastructure that we're using here is not going to be something that all the breeding programs are going to uniformly be able to apply. But the hope is that if we could define traits precisely through the high-resolution approaches and then come up with marker phenotypes that translate well from controlled environment to the field and across many sites on the field, so then instrumentation can potentially be developed that's very targeted, you know, and widely applicable, can take a lot of noise and still be able to predict you know, traits of interest, whether, you know, it's a specific wavelength rather than the entire hyperspectral cube. So those are the kind of things that, you know, at least as a physiologist, I envision that if you could, like, you know, stay green, but what could it be more precise than that? So those are things to, you know, I think they'll clearly come out from what we're seeing so far.
So I will add a little bit from engineering standpoint, I guess. So, you know, the breeders always talk about trying to capture very accurate phenotypes from the field. And I do understand that, you all need to, if you have a potential variety, you want to test it across very diverse sets of environment. But from the engineering standpoint, we also trying to see how can we, let's say, you know, there's a phenomics group at Purdue University, and there's one here at University of Nebraska, Lincoln, and there's one down south in Arizona. And then, so, everybody collects NDVI, but we don't realize that. And actually, we use different sensors and different methods to collect NDVI. So they are slightly different. People use different wavelengths to collect NDVI. So I guess, you know, from I guess, you know, CalMet does some of those is trying to see how instruments really perform very accurately in the field, because it is very challenging. Temperature, humidity, all those things would affect your sensor reading. So essentially, for the communication to happen, to be consistent, I guess, you know, you wanted to have a very set, well-defined set of measurement sensors to be used for collecting the phenotypic information from the field.
Yeah.
It's on.
I'm Vinay Saigal, again from Indian Agricultural Research Institute in India. I have a question on, really, when you get all the hyperspectral based indices, do their relative differences with respect to various genotype only are sufficient to work with going to the markers and genotype, or do we have to relate actually to some biophysical parameters? Because what I'm finding, Addie has really put up that she has to do a lot of ground truthing, ground-based measurements, and then develop the empirical models. And when you come to field phenomics, I don't think empirical models are going to work. It all depends on what is the sun angle, what is the sensor, what shading, windy conditions, and all. So that was one to James, Eddie, and to the PAT. May I continue my questions? Yeah. Two questions to the PAT. 20 years back, I was a student. I used to work with a hyperspectral radiometer, which was manufactured by LI-COR.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, maybe you may not be continuing for LI-COR for that long time. But I don't know over time when this whole the field started of imaging and all that, LI-COR stopped working on those areas. Do they have any plans to again start into hyperspectral imaging or spectrogeometry? And secondly, my other intervention which I need to know, coming from measuring a leaf-based photosynthesis in chlorophyll, when we will go out to measure the canopy-based? Do you have any plans or any work which is happening in those areas? Thank you.
Sure, I can give a fairly clear-cut answer on that, which is I can't give a complete answer on that. As a business, we're always looking at new opportunities, and so we see phenomics moving forward. And so we appreciate you as a customer and the things that you're interested in measuring, and it's something that we do have some expertise in. We have, as you pointed out, have worked in this area for a while. New products on the roadmap, there are some things coming that we're very excited about. There are some opportunities that we see to provide information that helps not only in the ground truthing, which is where, if you will, our wheelhouse as a company is, but also some things that are going to advance the science forward. Now, I can't get into absolute specifics on it, but I would say stay tuned in what's coming.
So I will try to answer your question about hyperspectral imaging. How does should we just look at correlation, or if we should try to find some physiological basis or genetic basis for that? Well, I guess your comment is very right. So my opinion on that is yes, we certainly need to try to see what is the physiological basis or genetic basis on the optical properties that we see during the change. So the way that hyperspectral imaging function is that you have some, you know, difference in genetic makeup, and that, like what Harkamal shows in their network that I don't understand a whole lot. But, you know, you have a change in the biochemistry in the plant leaf level, and that biochemistry interact with the light, interact with the photon that create a very specific hyperspectral signal for you to extract. So I guess, you know, you will have, I mean, only that you can make that connection between the hyperspectral imaging signal and the change in the biochemistry level, then you will be able to say for certain that, you know, that traits is actually correlated to something.
I have a short answer, and that is this is exactly what I'm working on right now. Yes, it's possible for certain traits, and you have to calibrate very well between your data sets, and you also need to, you know, fly when it's nice and sunny and, you know, use good data sets. So garbage in equals garbage out, right? Use the good data sets, use traits that make sense to do it, and it does work. As far as how that applies to other traits, we're still working on that. And one thing I'll note is that you can take hyperspectral measurements like with the LI-COR system where you're doing a leaf clamp and it's a very controlled environment. And you can also take them, you know, from the sky where you've got several hundred feet of air in between, and those are very different measurements. We're working to see if those relate or not.
Okay, so first I want to plug a project in Yufeng's lab. So you mentioned, I mean, the amount, both of you mentioned the huge amount of work of collecting these ground truth data sets. One of the things that he's doing is developing robots to collect the ground truth measurements that we can then use to train the models for the remote sensing, which I think is a very intriguing approach. But getting at this question of whether, if you have the hyperspectral data, do you need to have that physiological mechanism in between the hyperspectral and the genetics? If you're training with only a few genotypes, you definitely need to, because there's always a risk that something very idiosyncratic to a few lines, and then when you deploy it to breeding, you're going to get in a lot of trouble. I'm a very lazy person, that's why I ended up doing a lot of computational work. And so I think that if you have a trait from the hyperspectral data and you can map it to genetic loci directly without understanding the physiology, figuring out what those loci are is going to tell you a lot about the physiology. So you can reorder the three. You don't have to go through physiology to genetics, you can go through genetics to physiology.
One more quick question, and then we need to let you go to lunch.
This is probably more for Addie and James. Have you considered going into the higher nanometer range with your data collections to get past the reflectance and into the emittance? And how does that affect your research?
We have a couple of different multispectral hyperspectral technologies. The ones that we fly are not as fancy as the ones that we leaf clamp. but the technology is getting there. So I think this summer we're using one that goes out into the sphere. That's what your question is. So it's very high density, and it also goes out into a farther range. The leaf clamp that we use actually goes from, I want to say, 400 nanometers out to 2,500. So it's every, like, at least every nanometer. It's a very high density measurement, maybe every 2 nanometers. So what was the last part of the question there?
Well, and how that affects your research.
Okay, so. What we find is that obviously neighboring bands are highly correlated, right? And so you're not going to get a whole lot more information from having really narrow bands, but the problem is you don't know which ones are the most important unless you do that preliminary research first. And so having the really high density stuff on the leaf clamps enables us to know what it is we need to focus on from the sky.
So you're not looking in the 10 to 12, 14,000 nanometer range at all?
No, not at this point. That could be something in the future, but right now that instrumentation is very expensive. So the highest we have is about 2,500.
Yeah, so we've been driven by what equipment is already available rather than what probably makes the most biological sense. As was mentioned, these sensors are still very, very expensive. I think extending out definitely makes sense because, I mean, less to get that more precision, but if you're capturing a wider range of the spectra, you probably are going to get better predictive models. And again, we're working with folks in engineering to hopefully get a camera that's going to extend much farther out into the infrared.
And it's stuff out in the sphere that associates with things like water and biochemical properties. So that it's important to capture some of that high range. Yeah.
So stay tuned. And thank you for your presence and participation. Please join me in thanking this excellent panel.